Good evening, everybody. Welcome back to yet another CXO panel. This will be the last CXO panel of the day. And the title of our panel is Hardware Security, Foundational Block of Cyber Battlefield. The panel will be moderated by Vinayak Godse. Vinayak sir, can we have you here? Vinayak sir is Senior Director at DSCI, Data Security Council of India. Vinayak sir, please. And our panelists are Minatee Mishra. Minatee madam? Yeah. Minatee madam is Lead Engineer, Security Center at Philips Healthcare. Next, I would like to call upon Amit Sharma. Amit Sharma is Additional Director at DRDO. Sorry. Next, I would like you to pay attention to our next panelist, that is Aseem Jakhar. Aseem. Vinayak sir, over to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all for coming to this session. Since last session, I can understand there are a lot of things which is happening parallelly as well. So this particular subject on hardware security, we thought of putting this session to discuss, deliberate on at least two, three different areas in hardware security. And to cover that, we have three different panel speakers here, which covers three different areas of hardware security. So one, Aseem, which is trying to work on the security testing side. So he will try to probably take us through what things goes in terms of testing the hardware, and probably the IoT also brings very interesting flavor for that one. Minatee is primarily, she looks at the product security team of the Philips, and you all know that all of those solutions and products that they have has IT and probably the some of the IoT part is very critically inbuilt in that one. And probably development of the security from hardware side is where probably we'll get to hear from her. And Amit, with her, he's probably the larger experience working in the DRDO, can help us to understand what it takes in terms of supply chain security, what exactly the hardware security overall issue, and what we can basically do in the country to probably create a kind of competence in this area. So how can we take this particular subject of hardware security going forward? So to start with, I would like to start with Aseem to help us probably peel this particular area of hardware security. What are different components that do come into picture when we talk about hardware security?
Okay, so we have been doing assessments for around 10 years now, and 3-4 years ago we started looking at hardware and IoT. That's when we got interested into it, and we started researching on it. So some of the problems that we faced were, there were no standards, there were no guidelines. And how do you go about doing hardware assessment? What is the ultimate goal of the assessment? So we started the in-house research, and over the years came out with our own methodology of how would you go about doing hardware assessments. So from our perspective, majorly I think it depends on what is the ultimate objective of the assessment, or securing the hardware. So that is primarily, that translates from the usability or the usability of the product per se, or where is it going to be placed. For example, a very simple example here would be, we've done a lot of assessments on smart plugs, for example. Now, if a smart plug placed in a home with a TV connected to it, it does not matter if somebody does a cross platform or finds exploits it and shuts it down. But the same smart plug or the same smart switch, if it's placed in a hospital with an IoT device which is used to either monitor or inject something into the patient, and if somebody attacks that switch now, the risk factor totally changes. So it's primarily derived from the usability perspective. Now, what do you look into the hardware assessment? So we do more of IoT, so it's not just the hardware that we need to look at, it's also the software component tied along with it, the mobile apps, the cloud. You may have a very strong hardware security built into the product, but if the cloud is open, then all the user data is also open. So, from cloud perspective, we already have standards and guidelines. Even for mobile, we have a lot of guidelines. OWASP comes to my mind when you talk about mobile and cloud and web. But when it comes to hardware, we are still lagging in defining a guideline of how do you go about testing. So, I would divide the hardware into three parts: the user plan, which are the services running on the device, the OS or the kernel part, or the firmware, and the actual hardware. So, for some clients, accessing firmware is really important. For example, they are worried about somebody getting hold of their firmware and duplicating or cloning their devices. For some products, the firmware is available on the cloud for everyone to download, let's say for updates. So again, it depends from clients to clients on what is the risk that they see. So we did one assessment for a client where the product was a food processing machine. So their concern more was on the side of the recipes that were downloaded onto the machine from the cloud. That was their IP. And they were more worried about somebody stealing the recipes than actually hacking into the device and modding it or doing whatever. So from hardware perspective, then you have different components. You have the EEPROM, the memory, you have the microcontroller. The idea is to get inside the hardware or the system from anywhere possible. Below that is the actual chip, the microcontroller. And there are ways, even for example, decapping the chip and looking at the gate logic of the chip to actually find out security keys, for example, from the microcontroller.
Like in the testing side, so one is definitely side channel attacks that you try to look at, and sometimes even people are now looking at automatic signature analysis around the chip. And there's something that you do reverse engineering or even real estate analysis of the chip. So which are different types of the tests that people are performing on testing the hardware in various different devices? Can you just look at the different tests that, or nothing, you can cover those part? So when it comes to me, I wanted to come to you on the devices side. So in devices side, the hardware that you are putting in, so testing the security of that. So what are different type of the tests that do have evolved in the period of the time? And which are them that you have been looking at? Both Aseem and you can just let us know about the type of the tests that are being performed on this.
I'll start with it. So I've already mentioned some points. So, given the risk factor that is defined by the client, we put our own objectives also.
Okay.
So, we have a standard process that we follow, and then based on that, whatever the
client. And there are tools available to test those.
So we looked at the EEPROM. The process is similar to software. If you think of it as a process, you perform information gathering, you perform scanning. You identify ports, you identify the communication. So, for example, what is the communication happening between the microcontroller and the memory chip? So, you do some operations on the device and simultaneously monitor the communication and see, okay, if I am trying to log in, the microcontroller is actually trying to read something from the memory, for example. So, potentially that could be a password.
So, Minatee, so one is the testing part, but overall larger part of the product security. How exactly the hardware security features into Philips' larger plan of the hardware security?
Hello. Yeah. So, maybe I'll give you a perspective of Philips HealthTech. What are the kind of systems and devices it works on? And with the explosion of IoT devices, how we have been affected? So, traditionally, Philips HealthTech was typically medical systems which were housed in hospitals. In terms of security, they had a false sense of security saying that they are inside the hospital systems. So in terms of security, actually we started evolving about 5 to 6 years back, much later than financial industries. Okay, having said that, now we are coming in terms with that, but again we are facing a huge challenge of smart devices. Almost everything you see has become smart. You see a smart shaver, you see a smart spoon, you see a smart, maybe a wearable shirt. So I'll be happy if after 10 years they do not give a smart food, because that's the kind of trend we are getting into. So with this explosion of IoT devices combined with the traditional medical devices, we have a huge challenge of securing the entire product line. So looking at this from a holistic perspective, we look at the entire secure development life cycle, starting from the requirements to the design, development, testing and also deployment. So what we try to do is, at the requirements level only, we say what are the expected set of rules that a team needs to follow. Now, having said that, a rule which a medical device has to follow is not the same as the set of requirements a connected spoon has to follow. So there is a differentiation out there. Then it comes to also with respect to design. How do we design these aspects? So each component which gets into it, gets into your product, is it a vulnerable component? If it is not a vulnerable component now, is it possible that it becomes vulnerable after a certain period of time? It's very essential that we also monitor these components and see what are our liabilities in terms of license liabilities and also security liabilities of using these components. Apart from that, of course, the main thing which gets into the device is the design and the code. And we are as secure as the code which gets into it. So key component is the secure design and the secure coding. So it's very essential.
But then the application side, the SDLC process is quite mature now. We talk about DevOps and then we are also talking about SecOps. So is it that you can even, in terms of the hardware security design lifecycle and warrants product lifecycle management, is it really maturing to the way the application lifecycle management is happening?
Yes, yes. So we are seeing trends in that hardware security lifecycle maturity also. So typically what happens is we create a standard board which is usually, and that happens in every company, which is being used in every product. Now, earlier we were doing a hardware assessment to see if they are strong enough. Now we are putting in security hardware assessment, and these standard components are being security tested to see if they are strong enough to sustain unpredicted inputs. These are changes that we see.
Yeah. So now, Amit, to you, the larger experience that you have, and probably you understand this subject much better than what we all on the industry side understand this now. So what is the key holy grail of the hardware security that you see from?
To tell you very frankly, some of your points I don't fully adhere to. Let's talk about hardware security in totality. If you look at hardware security, initially, typically the hardware security lies somewhere in between what is called as the firmware, and then subsequently you are looking into right at the gate level or the component level infection, or what we call as the holy grail of supply chain infection. And that's the key problem to be addressed to. Now, I don't know whether you guys have been following. Just recently, there was again a news clip. I do not understand the veracity of it, and probably, again, I would say with allegedly, Apple Siri servers, they were hosted on the Supermicro servers, and the Supermicro firmware update was primarily bugged so as to provide a firmware level existence in terms of persistence of the malware code, which subsequently Apple alleged to be spying on the code itself. And that's immaterial of the application that is running on top of it, because what you are looking at is the main access which has full control over your entire stack development right from the kernel to the application space itself. So that's the first part of it. So when we talk about the firmware part, that is one. But what most of the people are usually do not talk about is the fact that things are much worse than that. Because if you typically see what exactly is supply chain infection, firmware, yes, it is one part of it, but there is much more beyond. And what is that? Is that you are looking at integrated circuits, component level, trojanized malware that is integrated within the hardware. And that is the holy grail of it. Why? Because when it comes to firmware, definitely you can always extract firmware. Firmware extraction is not a big deal. You can always extract. There are enough number of devices that is available. You can extract the firmware, do whole sort of analysis onto it. Typically, your dynamic malware analysis and dynamic analysis would yield out all the results. The key tricky issue is, how would you go at the hardware level when you are talking of the component, that is a gate level trojanized malware? Now, that is the key part. Why? Is because essentially because of the Moore's law. The way in which Moore's law is happening, your gate integrity has increased phenomenally. And that is the typical part. Again, but that's the, I still do not want to be the proverbial boogeyman in just telling you all this. There are solutions and ways, things that are going around. I don't know how many of you have been following. DARPA has been doing pretty good work. There was a project by the name Project Iris. And to the best of my knowledge, University of Princeton was working with them. Now, essentially what they are doing is that the technique that we typically apply for the application space, they're applying the same space to the hardware. So essentially what they do, that if you look at the larger aspect, the whole of the hardware scheme is divided into two particular components of our analysis. The first particular component, and I'm talking about now pure detection of trojanized components or integrated circuits right at the chip level, right at the board level. Now, one of the technique is typically a classical kind of a technique which is based on static analysis. How it is done is that a whole of the board space is converted into what is called as BDDs or Boolean decision diagrams. I'm pretty sure most of you from the hardware side are aware of it. The SAT analysis is typically applied onto it, and that is what yields what is called as the particular circuit board, which is not supposed to be there where it is working out. This is the statistical way. But adding to it, it is the most cumbersome way. Why? Because essentially the number of components that are integrated right at the hardware level, that is so high that conversion of a BDD itself is a Herculean task. And then analysis is again another Herculean task. So then the question rises that, okay, we have landed in one soup. What is the answer to it? There is another alternative approach to it. And that is where, you know, a simile for most of you, you would define from what is called as dynamic analysis. Now here, typically, not dynamic analysis, but something called as statistical-based classifiers on the signal emission for these particular RF circuits that provide the key. So essentially, if you look at, and I'll not go into the much because I don't want to be called the nerdy guy over here. So if you go into the details of it, essentially, if your board is there with the integrated circuits that are lying over there, if you do a signal analysis for the board, it is typically homogeneous in nature. But whenever there is an artificial or what is called as a trojanized circuit that is introduced into it, the kind of, if you apply a statistical based clustering algorithm onto that, the kind of signal analysis pattern that it draws are generally raising the spikes. Yeah. And that's the point where you catch that, okay, you rather than doing a DDD onto the entire hardware, you need to now concentrate only a sub component of it. And that is where your statistical extraction techniques go far beyond. Interestingly, it is not just the DARPA that's been doing it. There is one more place. There are a lot of research going on, and that's China. I still do not understand what's actually the need of it, just on the candid side of it, because many times a lot of alleged remarks are there from the origination of it. But you need to understand that hardware security is much more beyond and much more fierce. Why? Because to tell you very frankly, the way in which malware analysis technologies are emerging, for example, antiviruses such as 360 and so on, phenomenally, behavior analysis has changed the rules of the game. But what they cannot detect is something that is at firmware level
again, there are tools and techniques. For example, recently VirusTotal came up with some of the tools for the identification of the firmware-based analysis. But what is still a holy grail is the board-level infection. And where exactly, it is not just the IT space that it troubles. The board-level infringement can happen into anything. It can happen into military platforms that are there. It can happen into the medical systems that are there. Although intention of putting it into a medical system, I would still rule it out. But typically, when you talk about the military systems, the critical information infrastructure systems, that is where these kind of very strategic, because if somebody is doing something of this sort, there is a phenomenal investment that goes into it. And to such an extent that the tracks are hidden, that itself is a Herculean task. And that is where the key issue is. And probably, I think it is time for the security community, especially in India, to start looking at it. Unfortunately, yeah. I haven't seen anybody so far that is going into that details, especially in India. And that's something I would say that from nullcon, you guys need to take it up. Somebody has to take it up. And that's the way forward.
So, Amit, I think, so the assurance on the hardware side is a big problem. As she talked about is, for the medical side, there are some regulations which has been written and probably they are forcing you to look at the security part. And that is easy in commercial market, trying to evolve the market phenomena to ensure some level of security that goes into designing. But what about those critical infrastructure specific assurance level? So what are those different frameworks that can really solve these kind of problems? Are there really frameworks that we can look at, or we can't really rely on the market only to come up with a solution?
The key part again, as I said, now typically Vinayak, I can understand you said about the assurance level. So I can understand you are hinting bit about the EL levels or evaluation and assurance levels. And when you are typically talking of something of this sort, you are talking of level 4 and above. You are talking about custom protection profiles. You are talking about ingrained micro analysis, that too not from the security functionality point of view, but from the security point of view. Unfortunately, so far, it's been restricted to the application space and to some extent to firmware space.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you need to work out, it's still a nascent phase. It is still a nascent field because, as I said, you would hardly find researchers in it. Aseem has been doing a lot of good work in it, but it's still been very nascent. And the thing, and I would definitely implore you guys to read about the Project Iris. A lot of good details that's been coming out. And I'm not talking about something that's been going on in 2004 and 2006. I'm talking about something that is happening these years, just
and
now.
So I just want to drill more on this protection profile. So one of the important capability side, we may be doing testing, we may be doing the designing part, but the ability to define the protection profile itself for the requirement of the different set of the organization is a big ability actually. And I think understanding entire this gambit and probably come to that level that you can define the ability which can be used in designing the product. I think that those are the area basically we should be really working hard as a kind of user of the technology. If you are not developing the technology, we should be at least going to that level up.
Even protection profiles, I'll be frank with you, it's not, let me dwell a bit more about custom protection profiles. Typically when you, there is something called as common criteria certification.
Yeah.
And unfortunately we are moving away from the hardware security to more from the application assurance levels and so on. Now till the level 4, you are typically looking at the functionality component of it. The moment you go above level 4, you are looking into the security part of it. And that is where custom protection profiles. And custom protection profiles are nothing more than what is the rough framework through which the things had to be going off so that the essential artifact analysis would generate out, elucidating what is the key component of it. Now, what is the key problem in generating a protection profile? It is easier to generate it because essentially the theory is the same. The key part is whenever you need to go for a creation of a custom protection profile, you need to have the last mile detail of the actual design components, right ab initio, from the design, the implementation, including the micrograin analysis. And that is what generates out the custom protection profile. The key problem is that most of the OEMs, unfortunately in India, they are of foreign origin. And when it comes to sharing of, because in order to generate a custom profile, you need to share these details. You need to share these details. And that only would generate out for the profile makers to actually create that profile. And that is where the key issue starts up. Because even if you share something with you, when you, it comes to the implementation level, maximum you can go for the DD designs and so on. But beyond that, you cannot give. And that is where the challenge lies upon. Yeah. And that is what we need to address.
Yeah. So, Minatee, in the larger product development side, you are trying to build up team here in Bangalore. So, I'm now trying to come to the capacity building or probably the skill building in this particular area. And Aseem, I will come to you as because you do the training and this part. So, do you think that as Amit has been talking to you, there is nobody in the country has been looking at. So, do you also face this kind of problem where getting skills in this particular area is difficult to find?
So, yes. So, the deep hardware level technology is something which we haven't seen of till now. But yes, I think that's something which we can build on. So, what we have been typically looking at, the surface level IoT testing which has been done, which is associated with mobile application and the web server and so on. That's what we have been typically working on, but this is a skill set which is not yet explored.
Yeah. So, Aseem, from the skill building side, so apart from the work that you do, you significantly invest your time in terms of building capability in this area. You also did one training in nullcon on, I think, this part. So, how do you see how people are responding to the effort that you have been making to develop skill in this area? Is there any requirement? Somebody like to come to this area. Is there any requirement where he can get some kind of good job or try start to or start his own organization in this particular area? So, can you just focus on this part?
Yeah. So, we specifically went into embedded systems, hardware and IoT assessments for two primary reasons. First reason was that it was really interesting. And the second reason, we saw a market. And it is opening now.
Market because of now IoT and the devices which is coming.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So right now there is a scarcity of skills. I mean, but from the trainings that I do, not just here, even in Europe, I see a lot of interest in people. They really want to learn how do you go about doing hardware.
And how about the market for these services?
Yes.
Are people willing to get services from the external agencies to go and test their hardwares or test their devices?
Yes. And no. So, there are companies who have their established security teams who have been doing it for years, and there are companies who have teams but no number of products. So, some companies do not prefer to give out their hardware for testing. Other companies who are open. We get hired.
So, Minatee, I think Philips must be having hundreds of products. And most of the product would have this kind of issues which you need to address. So, use your product security covers all of those products at this point of time, or your.
So, this is a roadmap which we are currently planning, and as a strategy, from a strategy perspective, we do tie up with external vendors. It's making use of the specific skills, and we do see few very, very, very few companies who work on really deep level side channel kind of attacks. So those are niche skills which we are really looking at.
Yeah. So Amit, your views on if at all we have to work as a concerted effort from the community side, from industry body side, government side, what should we be doing in terms of improving our ability in the hardware security side?
Before starting that, just a small thing. There are a lot of opportunities that are there in this field. I'll give you a small example, and Vinayak, you must be aware of it. For example, the telecom testing center.
Yeah.
Now, there is a policy that is being underway in which telecom service providers have to get their hardware verified. So, this is not something I'm talking out of the blue.
Yeah.
That is something that, so the market is there. There's a huge market that is there. The important tricky issue is, again, as I touched upon the intricate details upon how the analysis is done. Now, the other part of it is how to create a skill set to address to that analysis. Because this skill set, you require a cross domain. You require people who are very much well akin into the microelectronics. The people who need to understand typical malware analysis and the key features that are there. And then a kind of people who are into what is called as system programming.
So you essentially need a combination of computer scientists
and mathematics as well.
Computer scientists, huh? And mathematics, definitely mathematics, because when you are talking of BDDs, conversion of these hardware components into the Boolean design diagrams, essentially it is polynomials. It is pure mathematics. So you require mathematicians also into it. So what you are looking for is people with cross domain expertise, and then you are looking into integrating them into a single coherent zone. So this is something that is, it's very nascent. I would say non-existent, to be frank with all of you, especially in India, literally non-existent. And that kind of a skill set is to be created out. You need to have people who are good at microelectronics. You need to have people who should have knowledge primarily of malware analysis and so on. The people who have sufficient knowledge in mathematics, and then using the same into a product component for subsequent analysis and certification, that itself is a challenging task. Subsequently coming with a framework. In fact, the field is so open that you can right now propose for frameworks. You can propose for international frameworks that would adhere to these kind of applications. And that's the challenging part of it.
Yeah. And there are some international frameworks coming in this area. There's a trusted computing group. I'm not sure whether Minatee or Aseem. So trusted computing group had been working a lot. So all the OEM vendors had been working on creating that industry consortium under trusted computing group, and they have been working with probably they have come up with a TPM specification, trusted platform management chip solutions or TNCs as well. So I just want to understand from Minatee and Aseem first view, are you aware about any of such kind of frameworks which are coming in and which we can leverage on going to this one? I will come to you Amit at the last, yeah.
So currently we do have focus on security, and the hardware architects are also looking at the TCG platforms, and that's something which is ongoing, not something which we've already done.
Okay, Aseem, you are aware about any of such kind of frameworks and standards, because you started with initial propositions that the standards and guidelines are not really available. Yeah.
Different industries have their own standards, and this particular piece forms a very small part of it. But those standards mostly focus on how to be a good boy. Like, yeah. How would you do this? So from the designer perspective. But when it comes to standards for analysis, there are no standards. How would you go about finding a factor on a chip?
So Amit, your views on those standards coming for designing and
I'll just give you a small thing, and probably the audience should decide it. For example, like TPM you mentioned, TPM doesn't do anything with relation to core embedded hardware kind of. TPM is primarily for secure boot, so that typically attacks such as the boot kits and so on, they are to some extent evaded out. Secure boot. Now, what we need to talk about, and that's where there is a lag of knowledge between the industry space and between the actual practitioners, that there is a lot of things beyond and below TPM. And that's the area I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Because TPM is still talking one step above. It is like you are starting the secure boot from the TPM. But what I'm talking about is that the microprocessor or the microcontrollers that are running, or the even the IC that is running, how you make sure, even if you have a TPM, if there is a bug that is there onto your IC level, it wouldn't stop it at all. And that's the lack of knowledge. That is what I'm hinting on. And this needs to be looked into, because this requires all sort of change in the way in which we see architecturally the security. If we are looking into supply chain, we need to get over this thing of firmware and above. No, it is about hardware and then above.
Yeah.
So hardware is not about firmware.
So with this note, I think I would like to invite the questions or any comments on this, so that we have another 5-10 minutes to spend on that. Anybody would like to? Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Should I just go ahead?
Yeah, please. Can you just? Who has a mic?
Please. Should I go ahead? Okay, my name is Pranish Prakash.
You have the mic, you are the boss.
Yes, and I work at the Center for Internet and Society, and I wanted to take off on the last point, right? What can we do, say, for instance, in the telecom sector, right, in India, the government wants to ensure that that infected malware, infected network devices don't get into India. What practically should the government do, given that there are no guidelines beyond something like the Crommon criteria, which don't suffice, in my opinion? What can the government do to secure the telecom sector in India?
I think all of the questions will come to you, Amit.
In fact, to tell you very frankly, this is something that Vinayak would be definitely very good at answering, because you can tell them about telecom security sector and the new telecom security policy. And that is something that is coming up with the licensing itself. So that's whole change of the ball game altogether. So that's, please.
So the licensing talked about primarily two, three things basically. So one, they tried to look at, but probably they withdraw from that key, the arrangement between the TSPs and service providers that can be also looked at by government, and they try to look at that part. But the one of the important part it talked about is the kind of fine that you may require to pay for such kind of thing that may found in the network. So that is a very important progressive way of putting liabilities, and the liability takes care of the incentivization to invest in security. Other part is primarily ensuring the local level of testing. So there are two ways for that. So one is the common criteria is a more standardized global mechanism where the supplier may not have to go to every time locally testing of that. But there are some small element in telecom side which definitely requires some specific testing. And that's why telecom licensing policy come up with this idea of setting up the testing infrastructure for telecom side. And they have been in the process of setting the labs, although it has been delayed for a lot, last 3-4 years of time. But we will see that happening in coming 1 year of time, because I have seen a lot of momentum there.
And in fact, it's beyond common criteria.
Yeah.
Because if you go through, it's still in making and coming up very soon. It's all
almost done now. Yeah, I think
It is about to come out. Yeah. And it is much more beyond the common criteria.
It also now talks about all the 3PP kind of standards.
Including hardware testing and all those things.
So my, if I may pose this a little bit differently, if there is some embedded, say for instance what we heard this morning, right? A single gate in a processor that has millions of gates and buses. If a single gate is tampered with, that can be proved to be a backdoor, and it's only activated with a magic sequence, otherwise it doesn't get activated. How do you even detect, how do you even go about testing for things like this? If there's, you know, right now, for instance, at the IISC lab, they're asking for source code from Huawei, but how do you even detect things like this?
So that is what I was referring to during my discourse. The thing is, first of all, a malware trojans or a trojanized circuit is not composed of just one gate. You simply cannot realize it. It's not possible. It's theoretically also not possible. Just by one gate. Because just by one gate. So typically how it is done is that you have a combinatorial matrix, and which is converted into a logic gate sequence, and that is what is embedded. This embedment needs to be done in such a way that the functional line of exchange for that particular module that's been running out, that is not disturbed out. And it needs to be ingrained into it. So essentially it becomes a part of the subsystem itself. So typically it is a whole integrated combination that is part laid into it, the system. Now, typically to detect such a high level of granularity, the best way to do it is what I said about typically conversion of these maps into what is called as, because typically if you just look at any gate or anything, it is very easy to detect out the overall gate layout. It is very easy to do that. There are automated ways to do it. Now, subsequent to that, you need to get them converted into what is called as a Boolean decision diagrams, and do a SAT analysis on top of it, and then you do analysis on the whole chain. But as you said very rightly, it is huge. You cannot do that much. So that is where the other technique that I told about is that you first of all do what is called as a statistical signal analysis based classification, through which identification that out of this, let's say, a whole gamut of code, this particular subcomponent seems to be tricky. And I'm again using the word tricky, not a malicious code.
I'm using the word tricky. The moment you identify these sub-components which are tricky, then you apply what is the initial component of what is called as the DDDs and SAT analysis on top of it. And that is where your code space for analysis, and typically even if your cyclometric complexity is pretty high, still it the code coverage would be much beyond than what you can do in the normal sense. So there are ways and means, but that, as I said, we need to work on it. And unfortunately, there is not much going on. Again, I would suggest, please go through. There is a couple of very good literature that's there as part of the Project Iris. Then Princeton, a lot of good research is going on. University of Wuhan, a couple of Chinese universities, beautiful work that is going on to this. But that kind of a mindset need to be created within our own security community within India. Yeah. And that's the way forward.
So I think there is a question, that's it, please.
Hi, I think I don't have a question, but maybe I want
to... Can you just log? Yeah.
I would like to comment. I myself working for Bosch, and I would like to say that, okay, me and my team is handling for the automotive part of it, of a security on a hardware level. So what we see is on a standard thing, like we mentioned that there are no standards which industry is coming up and those things. But I would like to see there are in European community, there are already a lot of work has been done in the, at least in the automotive field, for AVTA standards, which talks about that. And the same thing, I agree with Amit that, okay, in other fields we really need to do to the core level of the hardware, but in the automotive field definitely we have the standards. Again, okay, as Vasim said that, okay, it's only on the design level that we are just becoming a police. We are not going to the deep level on the side channel attacks and even power analysis, how to trace the thermal analysis system of the board level. But okay, IIT Kharagpur has a department, we invited them in our company to give research published by them, and they are working on this very...
Professor Indra Nielsen.
Yes.
Professor Indra Nielsen.
So maybe this might help to the consortium also. And again, coming to the point of skill assessment, because in this NULL conference itself, we have published our JDs. Even Philips also have published, Bosch also have published. But we are not seeing that niche skill set. And that is the example that, okay, people might be enthusiastic about this. But when I come to the reality, I really see that, okay, there is nobody.
So basic purpose of putting this actually session here with NULLCON, and we thought about this, at least to create awareness that this skill is needed in the market.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, so, but then I just thought, okay, let me comment because, and even like, as Amit mentioned, that, okay, maybe medical and automotive need not to be that much secure, and which is not necessary on the data integrity. But I don't agree with him because maybe data integrity, data security and data accessibility, these are the three pillars for the security things on the hardware level. So for that, we are the consumer people, okay, and more access is there. Automotive means nowadays everybody is using car. Medical means everybody is using shaver, okay, smart shaver. And then it comes to the final user application.
You misunderstood
what I referred to.
Yeah.
What exactly I referred to is that when you are looking for this kind of an operation, mm-hmm. you are looking into embedment right at the gate level, the component level. This is typically the quantum of investment that is required into this. Yes, anybody can do it, let's say, on a Maruti 800.
Yeah,
or okay. Let's say Audi A8. That's fine. But please, all these things, at the end of it, there is something called as ROI.
Hmm.
Return on investment. So if Audi A8 has some problem and it doesn't work out, you have got the idea of what I'm saying, ROI.
Yeah,
so typically, if you are going for such a high level, the kind of attacks that I am talking about, these are highly sophisticated attacks, and the quantum of investment and the quantum of coverage that is required right from the foundries to the product customization to the system itself, that kind of a pain typically is something that would not go into the field of healthcare or automotive design.
Okay.
So it would typically go into the what is called as a
state-sponsored or state-sponsored categories. So
or I think after demonetization, ATM might be the area where banks
so,
and...
So yeah. What Amit is trying to say is the commercial application and the critical sensitive national application and the sensitivity there requires you to go to the extent, and that extent requires significant level of investment. So that's the changing.
For example, if just imagine, one example is Audi A8 going down. To tell you very frankly, I simply don't care. Although the guy who is owning the Audi A8, he will have a trouble with it. But I don't care. But just imagine if the same board is being integrated, let's say in the sluice gates. Sluice gates are the dam in the dams where the water needs to go up and down. Those gates are called as sluice gates. So if the board is controlling a sluice gate and at a prerequisite time the sluice gates are opened, that would cost not just money, that would cost hundreds and thousands of lives. And that is the critical component.
And just to add on that, like you talked about Princeton University, but I had visited to Delft University in Hague in Netherlands. So Netherlands has this problem of DICE, the money, water management. So significant level of effort, if you really want to see what is the research happening in this area, probably you have to see some of the universities in Netherlands, the kind of investment they are making. So this electromagnetic signature analysis, one of the important critical solutions has come out of that kind of exercise they have done. There is a commercial solution available for that. Any other question or any other comment?
Just imagine Air Force One, you know, the presidential aircraft. Now, if such a hardware is there in Air Force One, just imagine that is something where the return on investment would be. You understood my point. So I'm never demeaning, of course, healthcare. You know, at the end of it, I'm a human being. So malware or no malware, I'm going to be troubled with diseases and all that. So it's important. But I'm just talking about ROI, pure ROI.
I've just answered your query. Two questions. One is about the standards when you talk about automotive. So when I look at standards, they are industry agnostic at the chip level. It does not matter whether the board is used in the car or whether the board is used in a healthcare device or in an aeroplane. So for me, standards and guidelines at a very low level, not from an industry perspective. Because when you come to the industry, you're talking about industry-specific characteristics. Second, European standards may have evolved. So we've been doing conferences in Netherlands focusing only on hardware security. I'm not sure if you're aware. It's called, the name is hardware.io. And automotive industry is one of the most difficult industries to penetrate when it comes to security. They are not willing to talk. So it's not just a problem here, it's a problem everywhere, even in Europe.
And third distinction that he talked about is standard are there for designing solution, but not there for testing and assessment of the... Any other point or any other question? Yeah.
Just a question, just lead to just... it's just a commercial question. We are all talking about smart equipment, IoT or hardware fallacies or thing. But nothing in legal terms, it is built into actionable damage or because of lack of standards or lack of hardware, maybe very heterogeneous area where you cannot build up a one size fits to all. So, but the main bottom line is if something goes wrong as a recipient of that hardware, I don't have any clause on warranty or any area to take any action against that particular supplier. And another last question is, because of a network device, it can have a consequential damage. Like in automotive, if you have a con rod, it can have fit in my engine. It can, because engine costs 50,000 rupees, but one con rod is five rupees. So it has a consequential damage impact in the other chain of activities. So it will be a very difficult until unless we come up with a standard and a regulatory framework to how to get back the damages on the pipeline.
I think Minatee talked about that. There are some obligations definitely coming which are leading to the investment in hardware security.
So maybe I'll speak to what's happening in the medical field. Taking a cue from the SCADA systems, now any issues that the researchers see on medical devices are getting, in the US of course, are getting routed to the ICS cert, and FDA, the regulatory body which actually controls the medical devices being sold in the US, actually is asking for your risk assessment, pen testing reports, and any such issue. Like, for example, we had an issue with, one of the companies had an issue with infusion pumps being tampered.
Yeah.
So that company was actually given a notice. All notice was given to all hospitals to take off that device from the hospitals.
Yeah.
So you can imagine the kind of regulations
so
we have.
The
in
regulators
medical
definitely are awakening to extent. Some of the area sectors are definitely becoming proactive with that. I believe with this we need to stop because we almost crossed the time that we have for this session. But I believe this really helped us to understand. It really definitely helped us to understand me. So please join me to thank my panelists here. And we will not like to limit this discussion here, Amit and Aseem, and discuss with them as well, and we'll like to discuss with you. Let's try to develop this community so that we try to engage the community on this particular subject. So and see next time when they put up this kind of requirement, you will get at least one or two reasons for them. Thank you. Thank you for joining. Thank you.